Once again, we welcome you to another Victory Hour, coming to you from the sanctuary of the Progressive Church of Victory, located at 416 14th Avenue North on Enid Ridge in Birmingham, Alabama. The Elder Oscar Turner is our pastor. We're so delighted to have you joining us, and we trust that as these services are aired, that you will allow the Lord to minister to you in a mighty way and to meet every one of your needs. We want to also invite you to come and be a part of these services. Join us here at the Progressive Church of Victory on Sunday mornings beginning at 9:30 for Sunday school and morning worship service beginning at 10:45. Join us again on Tuesday nights beginning at 6:30 for Bible study and Thursday nights beginning at 6:30 when we're preparing to tape for the weekly telecast and radio broadcast. Now, we want you to come and be a part of any and all of these services. We welcome you, and we thank the Lord for you. Also, if you have an urgent prayer need, there's a telephone number that you may call. If you need someone to pray with you, to agree in prayer with you, or to pray with you or for you, call us during service time at 251-7268. There are anointed men and women of God here in each service who have been made willing, ready, and able by the Spirit of the Lord to minister and to pray with you that the Lord will meet your every need. Our mailing address also, for you who would like to write us, and we certainly do encourage you to do so, our mailing address is the Progressive Church of Victory, Post Office Box 352. Fultondale, Alabama, and the zip code is 35068. Won't you write us, call us, but even more importantly, come join us here as we praise and worship the Lord together. We want you to know that we do love you, but most of all, Jesus loves you. As we go further into the services, open your hearts and your minds to hear from the Lord. Listen now as Deacon Zolly Murray reads from the Word of God and prays with us at this time.
Well, praise the Lord. Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord is good.
Yes.
And His mercy endures to all generations.
Yes,
amen. We just magnify His holy name and give Him praise and glory. Tonight our scripture is covered from the books of John, St. John's 10th chapter. That's St. John 10th chapter. And it reads thus. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter opens. And the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of a stranger. This parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not what things they were which he spake unto them. Then said Jesus unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. And that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter, in the end he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pastures. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is an hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is an hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, And I'm known of mine, as the Father knoweth me. Even so know I am the Father. And I lie down my life for the sheep. 15 verses of that 10th chapter of the books of St. John. May the Lord add a special blessing to the reading of his words for the edification of our body and the good of our soul. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you in the name of Jesus. Father, we come to you, Father, and lift the pitcher before and for thousands. Father, knowing that your love is more than enough to run over our cup. Father, we come tonight, Father, asking for a repentance of all sin, Father. Sometimes, Father, we've done willingly, unwillingly, Father, not knowing, Father. But, Father, we ask you for forgiveness of all those things. In the name of Jesus, Father. Father, as we journey toward this mark of the high calling, Father, looking straight ahead, Father, not looking back, not to the left or right, Father, going for that mark of the high calling. Father, lift us. Lift us up, Father, where we are down at, Father. Yes, Father, heal our bodies and touch us, Master, where we are ailing at, Father. Oh, Father, we just bless your name. We magnify, we glorify you, Father. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Father, touch the ones that are here tonight, Master, that are sick in their bodies, Father. Father, let your healing virtue flow right now. In the name of Jesus, Father. Father, that they may see comfort, Father, and ease the pain. Oh, the scorching fevers, Father, where they may be sick at, where they may be ailing at. You are the great physician. Father, just one touch, Father. We know that your healing can come. In the name of Jesus, Father, send down your latter rain right now, Father. Let it flow over our bodies right now, Father, that we may be comforted, Father, where we are ailing and where we are sick at, where we are downtrodden at, Father. Oh, Father, bless us this evening, Master, in your name, Jesus, for the one, Father, that trespassed against us. In the name of Jesus, Father. Father, we thank you, oh, Father, for being a quickening life, God, Father. Oh, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Master. Oh, Father, bless the mothers of this church, Father. The one, Father, just ain't able to get out through the night, Father. Oh, Father, but still our remembrance goes out to them, Father. And, Father, let them know, Father, touch them, Father, wherever they may be right now. Let them know that the saints are interceding for them right now in your precious name, Jesus. Oh, Father, bless Sister Joseph Mack, Father, one of the faithful ones, Father. Father, I know she has a church home, but, Father, she's just so dutiful here, doing your work, doing your will of you, Master. And, Father, raise her right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. Bless Pastor Mixon, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray, Father. Father, touch his body, in the name of Jesus, Father. Bless his wife. Oh, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Oh, Father, not least but not all, but bless that fivefold ministry, Father.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Guide them and direct them in the name of Jesus, Father, that they may see the light that shines in the tongue, Father, and that they may accomplish all things that's set before them in your precious name. Father, all we ask, these best we ask in your Son's name.
Yes,
amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus. Listen now, as Sister Gail Murray sings, "You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box."
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, soft-spoken anger, heard some folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, till at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was hers. As she poured her love for the Master in a box of alabaster, I come to my praise on him. Let all for Mary alabaster bar. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hands. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his arms around me. Seeing love, you don't know the cost of the oil. Yeah, you don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. Spent my day pouring my life without measure into a little tiny box I thought I found, until the day when Jesus came to me and he filled my soul with the wonder of his touch. Now I give it back to him, all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. I come to pour my praise on him like oil. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hands. You were there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his arms around me. Of the oil. Yeah, you don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box.
People who have a great anointing on their lives, and they think they want that same thing. Oh, that's what I want. But we just don't know the cost. We don't know the price that they had to pay to receive that precious anointing. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. You don't know what I've been through, and I don't know what you've been through, but Jesus knows it all. Oh, it costs something to go with Jesus. But it's worth everything that you have to pay for. Salvation is free, but there are things we have to do to make it to the kingdom and to live like Jesus wants us to live. There is a cost. Are you willing to pay that cost? It means that cost is denying ourselves.
My Lord.
Denying our flesh. That's the cost of it.
Yes.
Things that you and I might want to do in our flesh. But when the Spirit of the Lord or the Word of God says no, we deny our flesh and we say, I'll follow Jesus. That's the cost. But you don't know the cost of all in my alabaster box. Thank you, Sister Gail. Now, if you want to find out how that you can allow the Lord to fill your alabaster box with his holy anointing and his precious spirit so that you can live daily for him. We want you to know that our pastor is coming to us to deliver the word of God. And let us know more about what the word of God is saying to us at this hour. Ladies and gentlemen, sisters and brothers, may I present to you at this time the pastor of the Progressive Church of Victory, Elder Oscar Turner.
A little girl heard the story about Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs for the first time, and when she got home, she tried to retell it to her daddy. All excited and thought her dad had never heard it. But after she told her dad, that Prince Charming came along and on his beautiful white horse and brought Snow White back to life with a kiss. And the little girl said, "Daddy, and do you know what next?" And the dad answered, and she lived happily ever after. But the little girl said, "No, they got married."
My Lord Jesus.
Well, in the innocence of a little girl sometime, we get the truth in a great big way.
Yeah.
Get married doesn't necessarily mean the same thing as living happily ever after.
That's the truth about
marriage requires hard work and devotion in order to be strong. One other important factor in a healthy and happy marriage is a commitment to moral purity. From the 7th chapter of 1 Corinthians, beginning with verse 1, "Now concerning the things whereof you wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife have not power of her own body, but the husband. And likewise also the husband have not power of his own body, but the wife."
Amen.
I was praying the other day, and God brought this scripture to me, and I was reading for my Bible study time, and this scripture came across, and I said, "Well, Lord, I'll read it." But I want to talk to you tonight about marriage, the Bible way, not the way we got it, the Bible way. And let me teach it a while, and I'm not going to preach, I'm not going to holler and jump unless the Spirit gives so, and I usually don't feel holler and jumping when I talk about this, because this is a problem in the church. We're finding that statistic is proven that more Christians are getting divorces.
Amen.
In other words, they've stayed there a while and they thought they need to go on to something else.
Yep.
And Paul talked to the church at Corinth about marriage. Now, in another scripture, but it's hard to talk about marriage and not say a word or two about divorce. But Paul strictly stuck, he went with marriage. And he starts out his dissertation by, "Now concerning the thing whereof you wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman." As we walk in this world in 2002, I know of people say that they are Christians and they have extramarital affairs. They say they know the Lord. They come to church, they operate on whatever committee or board they're on, and they got another woman or another man beside their husband or wife. And Paul says here, first of all, say it's good for a man not to touch a woman. If that man is single, if that woman is single, it's good for them not to touch. Now you might say, well, how in the world are they going to court if we don't touch? And we are in a society where if people are thinking if you're going to marry someone, you should know them sexually before you get married. But the Word of God does not condone this. The Word of God didn't say you have to try them out and see if you're compatible and then get married. Well, now let me get down basic where you are. Because many times you can, if I stay up in the air, you think, well, it could be one or two or three, four ways. But God's word means for his people to live holy. And one of the things that is bothering the church, one of the things that is wrecking the church is immorality in the church. We don't know who our wife or husband is. And Paul said it's good for a man not to touch a woman, but he said nevertheless to avoid fornication. You ought to get married. Let every man have his own wife and let every woman have her own husband. Why? If you would partnerize or get yourself one partner, God can bless you.
All right.
Remember now, when the qualification of the bishop and the deacon came along, and one of the qualifications is that they got to be the husband of one wife. Now, I didn't write the book, but I'm just telling you what it said. And so you need a wife, you need a husband, and the deacon was usually a man. He said the qualification of that man, he had to be the husband of one wife. Some hold to that literally. Say if you're divorced, you can't be a deacon, you can't be a bishop, or whatever the word say. But the word say that you should not have several or be in a monogamous relationship. So to avoid fornication, sex without marriage is fornication. To avoid fornication, if you don't want to repent for your past sin, to avoid it, you need not even get into fornication. You need to marry if you know you're burning so hot, and you need to marry before you enter into fornication. That's the word. That's what the book says. Now, that would make more people marry and not